Good morning all. Myself Dr. J. Bhudriya, Associate Professor, Department of Chemistry, St. Joseph Institute of Technology. I extend my warm welcome to all the participants from various colleges and universities. With the blessings of Almighty and with the support rendered by our management, St. Joseph Group of Institution Chennai, and we, the Department of Science, St. Joseph Institute of Technology, proudly present you a webinar on material characterization techniques by Dr. S. Gokul Raj, Department of Physics, the Kandasamy Naidu College, Parliament, Chennai. We feel extremely happy that he readily accepted our invitation with his busy schedule. Thank you, Dr. Gokul sir, for being present today. It is my great privilege to address the speaker, Dr. S. Gokul Raj, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, Kandasamy Naidu College, Parliament, Chennai. Dr. S. Gokul Raj obtained his doctoral degree in Presidency College, University of Madras in the year 2006. He has published more than 170 publications in various reputed journals with good impact factor. He also completed two funded projects, DST, SERC, and DRDO, ARM, REB. He is the author and editor for three books. He has elected as Fellow the Academy of Science, Chennai, in the year 2015. He has good knowledge in nanostructured biomaterial, nanophase formation and investigation, the thin film of oxide on semiconductors and rare earth material, synthesis and characterization of material for various technological applications. We all know the importance of material characterization technique for finding the results in our research field. I hope that at the end of this webinar, we will have a clear idea about the characterization technique. With this short introduction, I take immense pleasure to invite Dr. S. Gokul Raj to deliver the webinar. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, sir. First of all, I'd like to thank St. Joseph Institute of Technology, Department of Physics and Chemistry, the management, and all the staff members for arranging a session on material characterization techniques. Vanakkam. So myself, Dr. Gokul Raj from Kandasamy Naidu College. So let me go directly to the overview of the presentation. This is of three classifications. First, I have made a general classification of materials for few slides. Then we will be dealing with the characterization. At last, I have just made the challenges and where and how to carry out these characterization studies. Generally, we have classification of materials. Let me call it as an engineering materials. The field in today's world, let it be any physics, chemistry, mathematical sciences, all end up in fabrication of devices, and with the help of all the engineering persons, those who are involved in the fabrication, electrical, mechanical, civil, and the all the end users, and hence it is generally classified as engineering materials. The engineering materials includes metals, non-metals, ceramic and composites. Of these various metals and non-metal ceramic composite, we generally classify the materials as polycrystalline, crystalline, and the last is amorphous. When we generally classify any material, obviously we need to go for the periodic table. We are going to use the same element from the periodic table. We'll be making it as compounds, and thereby these are generally made it as crystalline, amorphous, or non-crystalline, polycrystalline samples. So now, generally, we have crystalline samples. We might have seen that the given is a bismuth. So we have crystalline, polycrystalline. Polycrystalline is a single crystalline sample, but with sizes of micron to nano sizes. Then we have amorphous. Amorphous, which doesn't have any shape. So definitely we'll be looking after all the characterization of these materials. And now when we say about crystalline solids, we have atomic solids, molecular, ionic solids, covalent and metallic. When there is a metallic metal-metal bonding, we will be having a metallic bonding, and it includes the ionic, covalent and atomic solids. So we all know that there are seven basic crystal systems. So without going much into this seven basic crystal systems, we will be directly looking after the type of materials. When we classify these materials, they can be subdivided into organic, inorganic and biological. These materials can be used for micro and nanocrystalline applications. So when we generally classify these materials, we do have a metallic alloy. It can be hardness, for example, it can be iron, steel, aluminium, copper, zinc, magnesium, brass. It can be super alloys, so it can be metals or alloys. If you consider a ceramic material, it can be thermal resistance, brittleness for high temperature applications such as abrasive and corrosion nature, such as silica, glass, cement, concrete, refractory, silicon carbide, boron nitride. When we have an organic polymers or organic substance, it can be for polyvinyl chloride, polyvinyl explosive, for a refrigerant application, lubrication, fuels, medicines, adhesives, what not to say. So all these compounds do play a role in these subclassifications. The experience of designing and teaching this lecture is based upon the characterization techniques used in solid state chemistry and the material science. Of course, the area which material characterization is a common platform for both physics and chemistry. And at this moment, I am glad that both the physics and chemistry department has come together and in organizing this seminar. And hence, it will definitely provide a glimpse of this characterization. Among the technique studies, we are having powder X-ray, infrared, Raman, SEM, TEM, etc. for elemental analysis. For each technique, the researchers were introduced on the physical principles underlying the technique. So we have studied a sample examples from literatures. Now, what are the characterization that we will be discussing today? When we consider the characterization, it is a ocean. So at this juncture, we will be limiting ourselves to specific preliminary characterization. So for example, the preliminary characterizations are the one which we will be measuring or testing the samples immediately after synthesizing it or else fabricating it. So in that sense, we have just used characterization technique, X-ray diffraction. So then we are describing about the spectroscopic analysis. The spectroscopic analysis includes four basic analysis: UV visible, FTR and Raman, NMR. So now, when we say about electron microscopic, we do have SEM and TEM analysis. And the fourth part, we will be discussing about the thermal analysis. So DSE, TGDTA. So when we consider any of these characterization techniques, they comes along this electromagnetic spectrum. We are well aware of the electromagnetic spectrum, which can be either exhibited in terms of centimeters, millimeters or meters, or it can also be mentioned in terms of frequencies. When we consider, it can be from the lower frequency, from microwave to visible to high frequencies such as X-ray diffraction. Obviously, we know that we will be measuring X-ray diffraction for measuring internal body structure, bone, any dislocations. For this, we are using. So when we are using radio waves, it can be a shorter wavelength radio waves from infrared and ultraviolet to gamma rays. So all these are in the classification of this electromagnetic spectrum. So material characterization is central in understanding the relationship between structural properties. If I consider this as a characterization, it includes structural properties, performance and processing. The first part of this is, when we deal about the characterization, structural and physical properties, generally the physics, chemistry, material science peoples, we are making it. When we go for a fabrication purpose, for example, if it is a metal alloy, if it is an engine piston, obviously a mechanical student or a metallurgical student is going to have a feature. Suppose if you are dealing with a ceramic composites, silica or boron nitride, boron carbide, it can be used for engineering applications such as civil and electrical applications. Suppose, on the other end, if you are going to study about electrical properties, then obviously it will be useful for the electrical ECE people. So, the first part of this is the basic characterization by us, whereas the engineering fabrication is being done in the industrial point of view. So, now we will be dealing with the characterization analysis. The availability of these advanced characterization technique is integral to the development of metals, not only the developed devices, but in the form of manufacturing component. So, obviously, the end user has to be a common public. So, in that sense, whenever your testing is done, when it reaches the industrial process, it should be such that economically viable and industrially fabricatable components. So, the development and manufacturing of these components has been advanced for the mobility of advanced processing techniques. So, next. So, when we, just for a pictorial representation of a cartoon, we do some of the testing in the samples in our laboratory. We do some testings, we identify some of the compound and its property. So, that is what. So, then and there I have used some of the cartoons just to make people relax at this moment. So, generally, when we see about a solid state characterization, it may be X-ray diffraction, vibrational, surface and element analysis. So, these are the some of the basic analysis that have been widely introduced in the postgraduate programs in most of the courses, in the postgraduate courses. So, in the material characterization, all these materials are in the made of one or more of elements from the periodic table. In the periodic table, we know that we are having different types of compounds, hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon. So, like this, it varies. So, now, it is a mixture of compositions of these elements from the periodic table. So, they can be classified based on their mechanical properties. For example, if it is a mechanical property, we can consider elastic, non-elastic, ductile or brittle nature. It can be an electrical properties, where we can deal with the metals, semiconductor, insulating nature for these electrical properties. Then, we can deal with the magnetic properties, whether it is a ferrimagnetic, ferromagnetic, diamagnetic, paramagnetic. We can also deal with the dielectric properties, thermal properties. So, the property of a certain metals changes when its dimensions are changing. That is also investigated in these materials characterization. So, when we say about material synthesis characterization, the third part which is involved is a theoretical simulation. And most of our people, when we do an experimental, we do in somehow, we are not aware of the fact that the theoretical simulation and experimental can only end up in the industrial fabrication. So, we need to know about the principles, models and process and the critical parameters. Whenever there is a critical parameter, for example, if it is an engineering compound, definitely we are going to end up in the fabricating purpose. So, we need to know about the principles, models, about the critical parameters. When we say about the characterization techniques, these characterization techniques, they have some time resolution, energy resolution, which can vary from millimeter to angstrom unit. So, now if we consider UV visible, visible near IR, it can be in terms of wavelength. Suppose if it is visible, then we can have 4000 to 6000, 7000 angstrom unit. So, like this UV visible and Raman can be in between this UV visible to near IR region. You see that we can have scanning electron microscope, X-ray photo emission and NMR, ESR, EPR. So, all these are subclassified into this wavelength region from the electromagnetic spectrum. So, basically, the question arises, what is this material characterization? What do we do? So, what is the, that is the basic question that arises. So, now, we are going to have simply the samples. The samples will be like this powdered size. It can be, or it can be a crystalline, or it can be an ingot of any shape, cylindrical, in a diameter shape. You see that the samples can be in terms of millimeters. So, the quantity of the sample to be measured can be less than 50-100 milligram. So, the maximum sample for these characterization, it can be 100 milligram. Less than 1 gram of sample, we can do all these characterization. In some cases, it can also be liquids. So, basically, we are going to take some material in either powdered form or else in pellet or in solid form. Then we are going to pass some of the X-ray or any of the diffraction methods, so that we are going to find X-ray diffraction. From that we can also find out about the electron microscopy or fluorescence, whatever the studies. So generally the material which is needed is less than 1 gram for this very basic characterization. But when we go for mechanical studies such as tensile strength for determining the modulus of elasticity or strength, then obviously we need to have a bigger size of sample. So this is what we are going to see with the samples. So ultimately we are having a powder. So either the samples can be the powdered crystalline sample. Obviously when we say about the powdered crystalline sample, it can be crystalline or amorphous. So each and every crystalline sample, powdered sample, is made up of a smaller tiny single crystal. So the single crystal can either be mounted as a single crystal on the X-ray diffraction, or else it can be used as such as powder for powder X-ray diffraction. So we do have two types of diffraction. So whenever we say a smaller crystalline structure, it is a polycrystalline, it itself is a smaller single crystal which consists of a unit cell. So the samples, of course, I have shown the single crystal X-ray diffraction meter. Now you see that the samples can be the millimeter, less than a millimeter, it can be even equivalent to a millimeter. So we can have centimeter of samples, we can cut it a smaller crystalline sizes. Now we are going to load it in the single crystalline sample hold goniometer, or else we can also use it like this as a powdered sample. So what does that information gives? Now many information can be obtained. For example, phase identification, whether it is monoclinic, phase centered, what is the monoclinic phase, or else unit cell parameters, then orthorhombic, tetrahedral phase, what are the phases that can be obtained, it can be identified. And from the powder X-ray diffraction, we can always find the unit cell parameter. Then from, if it is a single crystalline, we can have the structural resolution, the reciprocal space mapping, and with a small amount of material. So now if we classify this material, approximately 95% of the material in the world is a crystalline. I say that the 95% of the material available for investigation in the universe is crystalline material. By applying X-ray diffraction in terms of kilo electron volt, it can be generated in laboratory with high power synchrotron and neutron radiations. We can find the structural analysis. It can be 10 power minus 10 meter. And the information, their interaction with the crystalline order, it can be constructive interference, which has been already described by Bragg's law. So this leads to characteristic diffraction pattern. With the interference, we are going to have diffraction pattern, and from that we can always have an analysis. So from both peak position corresponding to the lattice plane and also relative intensities corresponding to the lattice arrangements in the cell, it can be found out that whether these are, whether it is cubic, monoclinic, or orthorhombic, rhombohedral, face-centered, whether it is a face-centered, body-centered. So these are the various factors that can be found out. And we can also find out the unit cell parameter, the unit cell parameters which includes ABC, alpha, beta, gamma. So when I'm going for a crystalline parameter, if it is a single crystal, we can find out the unit cell parameter and what are the crystal systems. So if it is a single crystal, we can have a smaller crystal which is less than 5 millimeter. Even 1 millimeter is more than sufficient, but if we have even 5 millimeter single crystal, it is more than sufficient. Suppose if we are going for powder X-ray diffraction, then we can have less than 1 gram of sample for powder X-ray diffraction. So X-ray photons are scattered through this electromagnetic interaction with electron charge, while neutrons are scattered by the interaction with the nuclei. In general, the interaction strength of the X-ray with the matter is directly related to the atomic number of the material. So whereas the neutron scattering length approximately equal to the magnetic magnitude for most atoms. So when we are going to find out for X-ray diffraction or neutron diffraction, we can always go for any of the studies. But only difficulty is for a neutron diffraction, we need to have a synchrotron radiation where it can cause for multiple crows. But whereas when we go for X-ray diffraction, it can cost for a lesser cost. It was, of course, it is also costly, but it can go for few crores. So apart from the interaction strength, the penetration depth are also dependent on the atomic spaces for a number of technological important materials. So now, chemical phase identification. The most widespread use of polycrystalline or powder diffraction that we use in chemical phase analysis, this emphasizes the chemical phase, for example, investigation of high and low temperature phases, solution phases, and determination of cell parameters of new material. A multiphase mixer, for example, if it is a mixture of many compounds, multiphase mixture, a soil will show more than one superimpose. So by knowing one of the pattern, we can always identify what is the pattern, that internal structure it is there. So the powder diffraction method is well suited for characterization, for identification of polycrystalline phases. So now what we are going to do? We are having an ICDD, International Center for Diffraction Data. Normally, people call it as JCPDS. So this name was earlier there. It is called Joint Center for Powder Diffraction Studies. Now it is called ICDD. So it is having almost, you see that there are 75,000 compounds, that is organic and inorganic. Apart from that, there are many amorphous substances also there, the non-crystalline substances. But as a whole in ICDD, for a crystalline structure, organic and inorganic, it is around 75,000 compound data it is fed up in the ICDD data. Now, the quantification was done with Redfield refinement. If you want, we can go for Redfield refinement. Suppose we want to know what is the internal structure that exists, like the X-ray I have shown for a smaller bird. So, for the internal structure, whether what kind of structure it is having, we can always have this as a reference. So such quality analysis is now routinely used in industries also, right, from ranging from cement industry, oil industry, and can provide limits for 1 weight percent. So even if I'm going to have an impurity of 1%, I can always find the percentage of impurity. So nowadays in cartoons, every day they are showing many technological improvement, which includes X-ray in all the cartoons, whether it ranges from Chota Beam or let it be any of the Motu Batlo or any cartoons. They use the X-ray, ultraviolet, visible, all kinds of radiation. Before we college students, we know it, and of course kids are being introduced to this. So to show that as a lighter moment, I have showed this cartoon picture. So now you see that when we go for a powder X-ray diffraction, this I have shown a pure gadolinium hydroxide and gadolinium oxide for the samples. So this is one of my junior's work. It is on gadolinium oxide. So when we say about the gadolinium oxide and gadolinium hydroxide, here you see that we have used pure gadolinium hydroxide as form. So now I have to go for a JCPDS pattern. So what are the diffraction plane, HKL plane? It is there. For example, you see that what is the maximum 100% peak, 101, and the second peak is 100, and third one is 110. So like this, what are the peaks that arises for a pure gadolinium hydroxide? So now I have taken the JCPDS. You see that JCPDS, it is earlier called JCPDS. The card number is 832037. Like this, we have to collect the data from the standard JCPDS pattern, and we are going to superimpose it and we are going to compare it. So when you are going to compare, you should look after that, what are the ingredients? For example, let us consider what are the samples that we have mixed. So for example, if during the synthesis I have used gadolinium nitrate or any other compound, gadolinium sulfate, any compound, or gadolinium chloride. So first I have to classify what is the initial reactant that we have used. If the reactant used is gadolinium nitrate, so the process involves chemical synthesis, chemical route, or solid state synthesis. obviously when we are going for a nitrates compound where it is water soluble, we are going to make a precipitation or hydrothermal synthesis. Now when this method is made, now what will happen? The sample will result in gadolinium hydroxide. When there is a gadolinium nitrate, the nitrous oxide or nitrous mixture will leave it as a evaporation, or else it can go as a byproduct in the water dissolved. So now when we are going to heat it or anneal it, or we are going to use any of the dopant in this gadolinium hydroxide, obviously there are only two compounds. Either I am going to have gadolinium oxide in terms of gadolinium hydroxide or the erbium compound. So other than this, usually we have to think of the initial reactant. So we should stick on to the basic reactant. Now based on the reactant, we need to have their JCPDS pattern and compare it. From there, what is the shift that arises? For example, if there is a shift due to dopant in the 100% peak, then we can also match it with the same plane and we can cite that it can be used for comparison. So basically, we use the base compound as gadolinium hydroxide. Suppose if we are going for a dopant, so let us consider here in this case, we have used erbium dopant. You see that when the erbium dopant is used in as a dopant with less than 10%, the result will always be that the erbium replaces gadolinium in the site, cubic site. So there is only this option. Suppose if this is exceeding 10% limit, for example, if this, of course, this was done by Dr. Bhupathi, one of my junior in my research lab. So he found that one of the compound, this erbium, when it exceeds 10%, we can always end up in concentration quenching. So the concentration quenching is that when I am going to mix erbium with more than 10%, Dr. Bhupathi found out that it can lead to erbium oxide itself. So when I am going to deal with this pure gadolinium hydroxide with the erbium percent less than 10%, I can always match it with the gadolinium oxide peak and gadolinium hydroxide. Then this is another compound. If I say that it is a nickel ferrite. Now for the initial reactant, we have taken nickel, and this is one of the sample of Dr. Shanmugavel. He is also one of my junior and student. So now when we deal with this compound, here we have used nickel nitrate and iron nitrate. When we are going to mix this nickel nitrate and iron nitrate, obviously we are going to have the nickel ferrite. It may be in any phases. Now we have to start the first phase as nickel ferrite. So all the possible phases we have to take from the JCPDS pattern. Now we have to compare in which phase is crystallizes. So what is the maximum plane that is arising? So whether it is a 001 plane, 110, or 00010. So all these plane we are going to index. So now when we go for a particle size, we can either, there are two options. Either we can take on the full width of maximum. This is the full width of maximum of the 100% peak. Every peak I can measure what is the maximum point, and from that where is the half region and what is the width of it. So we can always find out what is the full width of maximum, and from the D by Scherer formula, D is equal to K lambda by beta cos theta. K is 0.9 if it is the crystalline sample is, if it is a spherical one. So this D by Scherer has lot of limitations. If it is a crystalline sample with one dimensional, two dimensional rod, this cannot be applied, even though there are many people who are applying this. So D by Scherer formula can be used, and apart from this, you can also use the extrapolation curve from this, all the peaks. From that also you can find Williamson Hall plot, from all the full width of maximum also we can find out the particle size. So these are all the quantitative, this from this quantitative we are making a qualitative analysis. So These are all, literally they are called semi-empirical formulas where it can be applied. So this is how you are going to match the planes, then you are going to compare it. So now, then the second tool we will be using is spectroscopy. So when we go for a X-ray diffraction, it can be used for a single crystalline, polycrystalline, or an amorphous compound. Here also, we are going to use the spectroscopic analysis. In some characterization, for the spectroscopy, the samples can be used as a powdered sample, a single crystalline whole sample, or it can be used as a liquid samples. In some cases, they will be dissolving those liquid in terms of any other liquid, then we'll be measuring the samples. So when we say about the material characterization, in this, the spectroscopic analysis is a vast field. So in that, we have fluorescence, X-ray spectroscopy, then flame spectroscopy, atomic emission, absorption, fluorescence, then plasma. Of this, we are going to deal with four of the topic: UV visible, IR, and Raman, and NMR spectroscopy. Apart from this, we have thermal and mass spectroscopy. And due to the time restrictions, we will be limiting to few of the characterization studies. So, a spectrophotometer is an instrument which measures the reflection or absorbance. You see, any sample will always either reflect or absorb the nature of a light. So, the instrument design necessitates that the wavelength of the radiation study would be a narrow window. So, in this predominated electromagnetic wavelength, we are having UV radiation from 300 to 400 nanometer, visible from 400 to 765. Of course, visible is nothing but a visible light, 4000 to 7600 angstrom unit. Then infrared radiation, which is below, which is far away from that 765 nanometer, which can extend up to 3200 nanometer. So in this infrared radiation, we can go for a wide range. So in this infrared, if the radiation in a particular and discrete wavelength is used to illuminate the sample, then there may be absorption of light. At other wavelength, such absorption will not occur. It is this absorption which we are using it to characterize. So when we pass the radiation to the sample, it can either absorb or it can reflect. So now the absorption of radiation may occur in transmission of reflection mode. So a graph is shown with wavelength versus the absorption of the spectrum. So mostly we are using transmission spectra or else absorption spectra. So this spectra can be used to determine the color of the sample, the specific response in the visible region, the sample of ultraviolet or near IR filtering characteristics, which is needed for evaluating the performance of the solar radiation control films, or difference appearing between two pigments. Like this, we can use it for any of things. Suppose if we are using for a crystalline sample, single crystalline, let it be a single crystal where we are using it for optical second harmonic generation, third harmonic generation, then you can go for optical transmittance. So whether the light is transmitting in the visible region. So these are the some of the things. Apart from this, from the visible, we can also find the band gap of a semiconductor, which describes the energy needed to excite an electron from the valence band to conduction band. So the energy that can be determined is called energy band gap. So this energy band gap can also be found out from the extrapolation curve of the UV visible sample. So accurate determination of the energy band gap is crucial in predicting photophysical, photochemical property of the semiconductor, because you see that we are dealing with the semiconductor which falls between 1 to 2.5 to 3 electron volt. Suppose if there is a point electron, 1 electron volt jump, so definitely, obviously, at a semiconductor region is going to make more. In particular, this parameter is often referred to when photoelectric properties of semiconductors are discussed. So, Tau proposed this model from in 1966 from the UV visible spectrum, and there are many modifications in this Tau plot. So, as I am citing Tau plot, it can be directly extrapolated from the UV visible, but it is not necessary. There are many modifications from the Tau plot, it has been determined. So, you see that your UV spectrometer we are having, it can measure precisely the transmittance or reflectance. Now, you see that whether the sample is visible in the region. So, if it is a green region or a blue region, ultraviolet. From the ultraviolet, when we go it, we are having violet, indigo, blue, green, like that. So we are having the wide range of color spectra. So in this spectra, what is the absorbance that is it is occurring? So how much percentage? You see that this sample, for example, this sample, it is a optical sample where the visible spectrum, I'm having a transmittance of more than 80%. So if you are going to measure the energy band gap for the sample, now we have to go for a optical transmittance or absorption spectra. From the absorption spectra, now we are, I just see that I have made a energy band gap for titanium oxide sample. And when we are going to extrapolate from the UV visible, you see that I can always have the energy band gap, right? So this is a direct method. So it is based on that, the assumption that energy dependent absorption coefficient alpha is expressed as alpha h nu power n is equal to A into h nu minus Eg. So this is a tau plot where you can find. So I have given the reference of the 1966 paper, Optical Properties and Electronics Structure of the Amorphous Germanium. So these are the some of the applications of visible. Now when we go for infrared spectrum, it is the region where above this visible region and near IR. We are going for a near IR. So a beam of light is produced and it is split into two beams. One is passed through the sample and other is passed through the reference, which is in which the measurements were made. So now you see that this is how I made it a pectoral representation. When the beam is split up, we are going to split up into two, right? So the light enters here and it is split up into two parts. So the beams are both reflected back towards the detector. However, they first pass through the splitter, which quickly alternates. So one of the enters the detector. The two signals are then compared and a printout is observed. So this is how we do obtain. So what do we determine from this? Basically, we in the X-ray diffraction have measured what is the structural pattern arrangement of crystalline structure. But in this, we are going to measure or determine what are the chemical bonding nature that exist in the samples. So it is, let it be a vibration length, bond angle. So it is there, we have measured in the X-ray diffraction. Now we are going to measure what kind of bond that exists in this internal sample in the FTR studies. So now basically we will be having a FTR spectrum like this. So this I have taken some of the spectrum as a reference. Now you see that generally the classification will give you two regions. One is fingerprint region, which is between 400 to 1200 centimeter power minus 1. From 1200 to 3500, 4000, it is called functional group. So the fingerprint, as like our hand as a finger, now this region clearly says what are the bonding that exists and the functional group in the second phase. So now the use of spectra. So what are the spectra that can be used for this? So now I can get the CH stretching, OH stretching absorption in alcohols, NH stretching, carbon double bonding stretching, so C and -X. So these are the stretching and bending vibrations that can be measured from this infrared spectrum. So to understand that whether it is a water molecule, is there carbon dioxide, CH4 and NO molecule, the observed radiations, it can be used. So basically, these molecules, as I mentioned earlier, the stretching CH, OH, NH, C double bond O, C hyphen X. So these stretching, whether it is vibrating along the plane, these things can be measured. So all organic molecules absorb in this radiation. So these absorptions tend to narrow and easy to interpret. You see that I have made the stretching asymmetric vibrations. So in the infrared radiation, you can have the single bond stretching, triple bond stretching, which is in the band region, and in the fingerprint region, you can go for smaller vibration. The vibration is used to compare the spectrum of the unknown sample with the known sample. So as an example, you see that one of the skeleton vibration, here you are going to have whether there is a bending vibration or rocking vibration, C single bond O, C single bond N, C single bond C. if it is a bending vibration, C double bond O, C double bond C, C double bond N. So suppose if it is a triple bond nitride carbide, it can go for 2000 to 2500. Suppose if it is a stretching vibration, OH, NH, CH stretching, you see that we are having 2800 to 3200. Then from 3400 to 3800, we can have OH stretching also. Generally, a smaller comparison. Of course, in the next chart, I have given a detailed classification. You can have the function group. From the function group, we can ascertain that what is the compound that is present for an organic compound, C double bond, O single bond, all these things. So this is what I have made into a tabular column. You see that there are vibration stretching mode for alkaline. So all these compounds, so single bond stretching and double bond stretching. So you see, if it is alkaline, alkene and aromatic compound, so the compounds such as conjugated polymers, benzene ring structure, aldehyde, ketones can also be found out. So from the vibration mode, we can always determine C double bond O, double bond O stretching and single bond. So these are the various stretching mode, bending mode vibrations that can be determined from this. Now we can have generally symmetrical, asymmetric, scissor, bending vibration. It can be rocking, wagging, twisting and bending vibrations. So generally, these material characterization includes, I already told that we can measure it for a single crystalline, polycrystalline or a microcrystalline, nanocrystalline shell. So the nanocrystalline, it can be very useful for the spectroscopic analysis. So we can go for magnetic material, nanoparticle, subconversion efficiency, quantum dot, silicon, metal nanoparticle, carbon nanotubes, so dendrimers, polymers, for various applications it can be measured. So the next is Raman spectroscopy. So this is a non-destructive chemical analysis which provide detailed information on chemical structure, phase, crystallinity. So it is a analysis where on par with the FTR, if it is used, it can be used as an effective tool. And you can always have the corresponding peak for CC stretching and C double bond and NO, all this stretching. So basically, infrared spectrum is an absorption spectra, where Raman spectrum is called a scattering spectra. So it can be rotational, vibrational and electronic. So when we consider this as a absorption spectra for infrared, obviously the excitation and the emission spectra are used in terms of scattering. So when we consider the spectrum of, for example, I have considered the methanol and ethanol, you see that it is also similar to FTR spectra. We are going to find out what is the fingerprint region, what in the chemical structure, what are the chemical analysis we are going to use it. So there are many Raman libraries such has been reported for all the bonding natures. So in comparison of that, we can make a tabular column and we can identify the compound. The chemical structures can be identified, the phase polymorphism, the, what is the stress, that the internal stress it is there. So these are the some of the things that can be measured using Raman. The next is nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. It is study of a spin change at nuclear level. So here also we are going to study about the sample where the spin changes at the nuclear level. So it can nuclei with odd mass number only, with the nuclei odd mass number we can have the spectrum. Now there are many type of NMR spectra, proton NMR, C13 NMR, fluorine, chlorine. Apart from this, we are also having solid state NMR. So it is an important tool for determining the molecular structure. So as I told that we are having proton, C13 NMR, phosphorus, silicon, all these NMRs are generally used for identifying the chemical structure nature of the compounds. So basically any nuclei with mass number or number which will spin, by the application of external magnetic field, the nucleus spin on its own and the magnetic momentum is created. This is called a ground state. So here we are using a tetramethylsilane TMS compound. So the chemical, basically we are having the chemical shift. The chemical shift is the difference between the absorption position of the sample and absorption position of the reference compound. Generally we are using tetramethylsilane. So this compound is referred as a reference compound. From this, what is the shift that is obtained? So by comparing the shift, what are the type of compound that the sample, what are the type of bonding that the compound processes? for a proton NMR, signals are reported by the shift from the 12H signal. For a C13, it is 4C signal. So the chemical shift on an NMR from a signal is normally for a tetramethylsilane. So it gives parts per million. It is normally in terms of ppm, ppm level, parts per million. So TMS is not useful for water soluble compound. For this, DSS is used. The dimethyl sulfone sulfonate is used. So we are determining the spin-spin coupling nature. The structural elucidation can be done. What are the types of proton it is having? So what are the number of proton of each type? So number of adjacent proton. So these are the investigation of conformational isomerism, molecular symmetry, hydrogen bonding, keto-enol tautomerism. So these NMR spectra are much useful for the people who are doing in organic samples. So they can be doublet, triplet, quartet, then quintet. So you see that we are having Pascal's triangle from which it can be determined. Now, example, I have made a chart. You see that we are having alkane, alkane, alkane. So all these samples we are listed approximately, if it is a CH3, CH2, CH. So for this alkane, 3 hydrogen, 2 hydrogen, 1 hydrogen, you see that the approximately chemical shift is 0.9, 1.3, 1.4. So depending on the number of hydrogens in the attached in the compounds with the group, we can always determine from the chemical shift, from the standard set of value, we can always compare with the standard samples. Now the hydrogen and carbon chemical shifts. So I have just classified some of the planar ring structures, ring structured compound, halogen, aromatic compounds, alkane and alkene. So these can be widely used to determine by the use of NMR spectroscopy. So generally, when we are using these NMR spectroscopy, we need to look at the process before it is being made. So the basic analysis is understanding the property, the nature of the sample, the structure of it, and then we need to process it. So this is how we are going. So now the next stage is electron microscopy. So I would like to thank Dr. Siddheshwaran, professor of physics in Pachepas College, so who has contributed to this electron microscopic method. So some of the slides I have taken reference from his reference. So now the transmission electron microscopy, we have electron microscopy, we have TEM, SEM, STEM and REM, reflection electron microscopy. We are going to deal with the two of the electron microscopy. It is with the scanning electron and TEM, transmission electron microscopy. You see that in normal microscopy, this is called normal microscopy, it is called light microscopy. We have a light source, a condenser, specimen, an objective lens and an eyepiece where we can view the image directly. But here you see that the electron is diffracted. Through the electron diffraction, we are going to have the sample imaging. So the electrons are emitted thermionically by the use of tungsten or by field emission by LAB6 crystal from the electron gun. So the beam passes through it. So you see that the beam passes through it and we are having a condenser lens and a projective lens. But here you see that in the scanning electron microscope, we are having the diffraction pattern with the use of condenser cell. So this is the setup which we are having. So with this setup, what is the result that we will be obtaining? With this result, with the help of a scanning electron microscope, we can find out what is the pattern in which the surface is made up of. We can look at the image in terms of microscopic view to the nanomaterial view. You see that it is, we can go around even for 100 nanometer. So you can see the surface pattern. This is a cross-sectional image. So this is a cross-sectional image of a thin film and also surface view. This microscopic view can be obtained. So this is one of the slides from Dr. Siddheshwaran. See that it's a titanium oxide single crystalline. So each polycrystalline is made up of a single crystalline. And this single crystalline nature can be found out in this way. So you see that their formation, beautiful structural formation. This is how we can find out the surface morphology and the surface, the compound nature in terms of micron to nano view. So when we consider the TEM, transmission electron microscope, you see that the backscattering electrons are used in the SIM, and we are having the samples, and from that samples we are also having elastic and inelastic scattering. So what do we obtain from the TEM? Basically, here also we are going to view the images of the nano images of the samples. Let it be any sample. So we are going to view in terms of 10 nanometer to 500 nanometer. Even if it is high resolution transmit electron microscope, you can go towards the view of 1 nanometer. So you see the TEM image where people have viewed 1 by 10th, that is 1 by 10 nanometer is 1 by 10th of a nanometer. So the size is here 10 nanometer, and in the second image HR-TEM, it is a 5 nanometer image. This is one of the image of a multi-wall carbon nanotube provided by Dr. Siddheswaran. So here we do have all kinds of samples in terms of nanoscopic image. So from this, if this scanning electron microscope and TEM is attached with the EDS spectrum, energy dispersive analysis spectrum, we can find out what is the element, whether it is cerium, neodymium, copper, cobalt, all the compound that exists in the sample. So here you see that he has given a sample on neodymium doped cerium oxide. So this cerium oxide consists of natural phase in its phase, and neodymium is made as a dopant. See, there are some of the phases of neodymium. So these can be used for a cross-sectional view. This is a high resolution electron area electron diffraction. These patterns can be obtained from it. So then now the next part of it is thermal analysis. In the first part, you have made structural analysis. So when you are going for a structural analysis, you are using X-ray diffraction. As far as myself is concerned, whenever a sample is determined for a structural property, it should be combined with the X-ray and the thermal analysis to ascertain the compound nature and stability. So that is why I have included the thermal analysis. So basically, X-ray is used for a structural diffraction pattern. From the X-ray diffraction, you are determining what is the crystalline phase and all. But now the thermal analysis will reveal you what are the phases that is going to change as the temperature changes. So generally, the thermal analysis is subclassified into three categories. One is mass spectrometer, where the weight changes. The second is the temperature of the heat flow, where we can have differential thermal analysis and differential scanning calorimeter. Apart from this, we can have dimensional changes also. There can be a size change. The size can be changed in terms of dimensions. By applying thermal properties, the size of the material can change. So for this thermal analysis, thermal analysis is a destructive analysis tool. Suppose if you are going to use a sample, suppose I can use in terms of microgram of samples in TGDTA. Of course, we will be showing some of the sample holder. If you use it, definitely the compound will get decomposed. So this is a destructive analysis tool. If a reaction between two substances shall be started, so we are using two reactants, it can produce a product. Now this product can transform from one phase to another phase. So this phase, you are going to make it as a phase diagram. So generally, the phase diagram represents the compound nature that exists in terms of variation between a temperature and a pressure, whether it is a solid or a liquid or a gas. So what are the type that exists? So this is a phase diagrammatic representation of compound. So we are going to ascertain what is the phase change. Suppose if the phase, we have just seen some of the steel, whether it is a ferrite phase, austenite phase. From the phase, it changes from body centered to face centered. So the phase transitions can be obtained. You see that here at 600 Kelvin, it exists in the BCC phase. And from the pure BCC phase, the pure ion changes to austenite phase. So in terms of metallurgical point of view, this thermal analysis is the most important tool, because when we go for a fabrication of mechanical compounds, if a mechanical engineering student, they are working on a research problem, if they are going for a thermal analysis, then they have to analyze these thermal parameters in terms of the materials as a whole. It can be an engine piston or a heat resistant piston. So these things needs to be studied. So then in this thermal analysis, generally they are classified into calorimetric, gravimetric and thermal analysis. Now, thermal analysis, generally, it involves measuring of a sample mass change. So, when the temperature is heated, as I heat the temperature, it will lose its sample. For example, if I take some of the organic compound, it might lose water molecule, the carbon dioxide molecule. So, some of the chemical nature might change. So, what are the thermal, what is the chemical splitting that occurs due to the apply of the heat? So, generally, it is applied in absorption, corrosion, decomposition reaction. Suppose if the chemical compound disintegrates or decomposes, stepwise degradation can be obtained. So, this is what the application of the thermal analysis. So, if you consider the differential scanning calorimetry, it is most frequently imposed and used tool. So, I can find the melting point, the melting crystallization period, the polymorphism method, what is the glass transition and decomposition behavior. From this decomposition, it can be. So, these are widely used in generally. Differential scanning calorimetry is used by physics, chemistry people, mechanical, metallurgy, and also it is used for biological people. You see that we have seen some of the ionic liquids. So, for example, if it is an ionic liquid, we have considered one of the ionic liquid. If you are going to make it, generally for a heating and cooling curve, you see that recrystallization can occur. In general, the thermal analysis is subdivided into two classifications. One is basically the variation is mass change and also in heat flow change. So, it can be either exothermic and endothermic. You see that general exothermic DSC curve for endothermic peak which absorbs heat will show in the bottom direction, and exothermic reaction which releases heat, and I have mentioned the peak in the green peak in the upward side. So, exothermic in the upward direction and endothermic in the downward direction. So, we have to first look over which direction is the power is there. So, generally when we consider the DSC analysis, we can have glass transition, cold crystallization, the melting behavior. So, all this can be obtained. So, this is how. So, when we see that here you see that when we are making a first heating, we are having the blue curve as an endothermic. During the glass transition, there is nothing happened. But whereas you see that the glass transition during the cold crystallization, there is an exothermic peak after which there is a melting occurs, which represents the endothermic curve. So, generally, the properties are measured as a function of time or both. So, it can be a crystallization, glass transition, or any of the phenomena that is related to the heat. Now, you see that generally the thermal analysis sample, this is how the pictorial representation, this is an image of the sample holder. You see that the sample holder is less than 5 millimeter, almost it is 8 millimeter. So, now you are going to place a sample as a powder, solid or a liquid. So, solid it can be a single crystalline or else a powdered sample. So, here I can place a sample which can be a millimeter type to 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter crystal or else powdered sample. So, when we are, so with the help of this thermal analysis, can go for reaction calorimetry, thermal aging, thermal safety for this biological materials also. So, this is widely used for chemical analysis for thermal compound. For example, let me have an example for a calcium oxide monocrystal. You see that this is TGDT, thermogravimetric analysis, differential thermal. So, when the green line in the first curve, so it represents first stage, there is one weight loss, then second weight loss, then there is a third weight loss. So, the first weight loss, there is a mass change of 12%. Now, from the calcium oxide monohydrate, we are calculating what is the weight percentage of this molecular weight of this water molecule, then carbon dioxide. So, when we compare it, what is the enthalpy joule per gram that is exhibited? So, what is the theoretical mass loss and what is the experimental mass loss? So, by this 12%, we can assume that it changes into calcium carbonate and water molecule. If at the first stage, the water molecule, which is around 12%, there is a loss. Then when we go for heating beyond 150 to 200, obviously at 100 degrees Celsius, everyone knows that water molecule evaporates. So definitely at till 200, there will be this water molecule. When we are going to measure this carbon dioxide, the second phase, almost 18-20% of weight loss is there. So now this can be represented in terms of carbon monoxide, where its molecular weight is around 18%. Then in the second stage, it is split up into calcium oxide and calcium carbonate. Now you see that calcium carbonate, we have a mass loss of almost 30%. So in all this, the error can be less than 2-5%. So we can assume that the error percentage is less than 2%. And here in this experiment, it is almost less than 2%. So the TGA curve and DSE curve in combined together, they can have they can be measured for the mechanical application, for organic material, inorganic material, for biological samples. So we can either find out the dehydration behavior, the polymorphic phase transition, the melting point. So the thermogrammetric with the differential scanning calorimetry, we can have these kind of things. Then the other thing is thermomechanical analysis. For the thermomechanical analysis, it is a change in dimension. So that it can be the glass transition, cold crystallization and melting. So generally the thermomechanical analysis for a polymer type of compound or a thermal expansion shrinkage behavior, this is very much helpful. So if you want to classify in general, the material characterization can be determined for each and every sample. So every method cannot suit all type of material. First, we need to look out what kind of material we are going to investigate, whether it is a metallic nature, it is an organic or inorganic, or it is an amorphous compound, whether it is a single crystalline, whether it is a powder sample, whether it is a liquid crystalline, liquid sample. So these sample nature first should be ascertained. Then we need to go for, depending on the spatial resolution, whether we are going to go for bulk sample, whether we are going to go for microcrystalline sample, whether we are going to go for nanocrystalline sample. Depending upon the sample nature, you need to first ascertain with a benchwork. So basically, the research initiative at the start should be well enough that we should understand what is the problem that we are investigating and what is the limitation in each and every instrument that we are measuring, whether it is X-ray diffraction, FTR, XPS studies, Raman, SIM, TIM. So all these studies, optical studies and AFM, we need to ascertain the nature of the compound, then we need to go for the analysis. So when we say about the microscopic nature, generally in terms of, it can be a crystallographic nature for electron microscopy. For this electron microscopy, obviously, when we are having a microcrystalline or nanocrystalline sample, we can go for an electron microscopy. Apart from this, when we are having a sample with the surface morphology, different surface morphology, definitely we can go for electron microscopic technique. It can be scanning electron microscopic and transmission electron microscopy. Then thermal imaging techniques can also be used. So basically, when we are dealing with any of the compound, we can always have the crystallographic method for identification of the compound, the phase analysis in combination with, for example, in combination with these thermal analysis. Suppose if I am having a simple cubic to body center to face centered cubic transition, or else the inverse, for example, if there is a body centered or face centered cubic, if a structure from monoclinic changes from a cubic state, then the stability increases. Obviously, we need to investigate both X-ray diffraction and thermal analysis. By this thermal analysis, we can always ascertain what is the polymorphic phase transition that is obtained. So we can have in combination with this thermal analysis, what is the phase that it changes, what is the crystalline nature it changes. So these can be used in combination with this thing. So this is how, when you are going to investigate spectroscopic analysis, the spectroscopic tools must include UV visible, FTR, Raman and NMR. Combined together, we can always corner the sample, and thereby whatever the property that we are going to investigate, the property which is electrical, magnetic material, That is the next part. But the basic analysis, these are the basic tools you are going to ascertain the nature of the compound. Suppose whether the synthesized compound is of the for example, when it is in the calcium oxalate monohydrate phase, it may be in one phase. When water molecule and carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide, it keeps on losing, you see that there is a mass change. When there is a mass change, there is a change in differential thermogrammetric analysis, DTA also. So simultaneously, we can carry out differential scanning colorimetry. You see that in the differential scanning colorimetry, there is an exothermic peak. That exothermic peak, we are just having between, you see that 110 to 200. And another one endothermic peak at 400 degree. So by simultaneous analysis of differential scanning colorimetry and thermal gravimetric analysis, we can always compare the samples, nature, and thereby always we should have a reference material. These reference material can be compared. So while determining the nature of the compound, it is true that all the analysis cannot be used for each and every compound. Depending on the nature, we can use it. So at the concluding part, so this is our spectroscopic tool. So whatever the thing, so just I have shown to conclude this remark, I have showed a tip of an iceberg. So this is a famous quote, it's a tip of an iceberg. We have shown a small glimpse of what the characterization, basic characterization is about. So with the help of this, you need to investigate what is underneath below this sea. It's a lot more task. So the single power presentations cannot be satisfying all your research needs. Of course, I have showed some of the tip of an iceberg, and I'll also in the next slide, I'll be showing what are the last part. Now, we are measuring the compounds. Where do I need to measure these compounds? Who offers these facilities? For example, science and technology throughout India has almost established 18 R&D sophisticated analytical instrumental facility. It is called SAIF. It is there in throughout the country. It is there in 18 centers across the countries. In IIT, it is also there. It is a science and technology funded science program. So there we are having a lot of characterization facilities. Like that, each and every university, whether it is a government university, central government university, central universities, or private university. For example, we are having Satyabhama University, we are having SRM University, so Veltech University. These universities offer instrumental services where we can measure on the basis of payment basis. So this is a science and technology facility where it has been established. Apart from this, various funding agencies have sponsored many labs. Through that, many samples can be tested. So if you consider this, you see that we are having SAIF facilities at IIT Madras, IIT, IIT Bombay, AIMS, and SAIF at Guwahati, Punjab University. Apart from this, we are also having state universities such as University of Madras, Madurai Kamaraj University, Bharathiyar University, Bharathidasan University. So all these universities are there. Apart from this, we are having CSR labs, DRDO labs. So there also we can have our samples tested. So in some of the organizations, they in these SAIF central facilities, they do offer the service on payment basis. For example, you see that SAIF facility, you are having mass, UV visible, fluorescence, FT Raman, FTI spectrum. They offer service for around 500 rupees to 1000 rupees, which varies depending on the sample, nature, and also depending on the characterization. Suppose, for example, if it is a single crystal X-ray diffraction, it can cost you about 4000 to 5000 for a research scholar or a student. So in some of the research facilities, they are offering services on payment basis. In some of the centers, you need to go and talk to the scientists to have an official collaboration. For example, ARCA is there at Hyderabad, in International Advanced Research Center for Powder Metallurgical New Materials, ARCA. And in Chennai also, you have some ARCA center where battery fuel cell research is going on. So like that, you can go and visit their centers and you can have a collaboration. So when we deal about the characterization techniques. As I said earlier, a single lecture presentation or a single discussion cannot end up in fruitful suggestions for your research work. Of course, there are various books available, literatures, and you can also go for these. For example, these are some of the books that I have displayed for material characterization, right from the Encyclopedia, from Springer, from Elsevier, Taylor and Francis. All these people, they have published books, so you can refer these books for your material characterization. So this is how you have to end up in this stage. So finally, before ending up the note, I want to conclude that first have faith in yourself. So have faith in the sense, if you are going to start about a research or a plan, you do choose a topic, you constrain yourself, then know that one may be little bubble and another may be a mountain highway, yet behind both the bubble and the wave, there is an infinite ocean. Therefore, there is a hope for everyone. As I say this always from the Vivekananda quote, so Jai Hind. Thank you. Thank you for making a wonderful session.
Good afternoon. I am Silvarani, Assistant Professor and Department of Chemistry, St. Joseph Institute of Technology. Thank you, Dr. Gokulraj sir, for your wonderful presentation. Our participants raised few questions in the chat box for
yes,
your answer.
Definitely.
Okay. First question.
The first question is, if the particle possesses amorphous nature, then we need to take SEM. Whether amorphous or crystalline, the first question is whether you want the face. So how does this face looks? Whether it is a, for example, you might have seen in the structural pattern of the SEM. Suppose if you are having SEM facility and you want to investigate on the surface of the SEM, definitely you can go for SEM for amorphous. The second is Dhanalakshmi Brahmasuri from sir, can we obtain reflectance spectrum from absorption spectrum and transmittance spectrum? There is no need. Whenever they are going to give you the result, whether it is IIT or IISc or any of the institute, definitely they will give you the reflectance and absorption spectrum. No need to worry. You don't need to convert. They will give you both reflectance and absorption spectrum. So then next is B. Karthikeyan. He has asked, what is the difference between optical gap and electronic band gap? See, optical band gap. That's next question. Please just hold on. I'll answer on. See, definitely we do have energy band gaps, and these are in the optical region. We are going to find out from the spectrum, visible near IR spectrum, and we can always evaluate from the earlier equation that I have mentioned, right? So the next question, what is the Brahmasundari question? Can we relate the color of the nanomaterial with the absorption spectrum? Definitely. For example, if you go for a gold nanoparticle, the color of the nanoparticle will vary. So gold, you think that all that glitters is not gold, right? So gold is, you are having a bright yellow. When we go for a particle size, gold will change its color to blue to green. Then obviously the color will change. Definitely the color will change. The next question. We have sample 001 subjected to X-ray diffraction 0 to 2 and appeared. Give reasons for 0. See, 001, 003, 006 are appearing in spectrum. See, these are multiples. For example, it is HKL. So it is a diffraction. Definitely, if there is a 001, definitely there will be. So it is a multiplicity of that pattern. Definitely it will be there. For any sample, the only thing is whether the sample is such enough that it can reflect this spectrum. Definitely it will be there. The next question. So what is the use of Saranya from the, what is the use of photoluminescence? So we are having an absorption energy band gap. We can always find out from the emission spectrum what are the emissions that is obtained. So for example, I can have a spectrum at 450 nanometer. 350 nanometer, I can go for laser excitation. From the excitation spectrum, we can always have what is the emission spectrum that it emits in that wavelength region. So it can be applied for that. The next question. Why we are choosing copper? No, we are, there are many targets. Generally, copper is 1.5406 angstrom unit. There are other targets. There are molybdenum source also there. There are two, three targets available which can emit high X-rays. That's why. The reason for it is generally copper emits good radiations of 1.5406 angstrom unit. We can go for molybdenum source also. In powder extract, there are molybdenum source also there.
Thank you once again, sir, for your wonderful interaction. I want to thank our chairman, Dr. B. Bob Monogren, St. Joseph Group of Institution, Mrs. B. Jessipriya, Managing Director, St. Joseph Group of Institution, Mr. B. Sashi Shekhar, Director, St. Joseph Group of Institution, for giving opportunity for conducting this program. And also I thank our principal, Dr. P. Ravichandran, St. Joseph Institute of Technology, for this constant support for this webinar. Finally, I thank our department HOD and convener of this webinar, Dr. N. Badbumalni, and faculty members giving full support in this event to success. Once again, I thank to all the participants for your kind cooperation. Thank you. Thank you, sir.